Galleon, and welcome to Peaceworks. In this episode, we're going to hear from Tony Campolo. We asked some people this question. Does being peaceful mean not being violent towards animals and the environment?
I think so. I think that it's all God's creation, animals, the environment, us. So we have to be peaceful to everything. I don't think it means that we all have to go out and be vegetarians. I just think that we can go about life in a more peaceful way towards our environment and towards animals. I mean, if you appreciate God, you'll appreciate the creations that He gave you. And I think the only way to go about appreciating that is being peaceful towards them.
God created animals so that we could have food and we could survive. If without food in nature, like, because the environment makes all our food and the animals make all of our meats, like the environment makes all our vegetables and fruits and all that, and then like animals make our bacon or everything.
I think it depends on how much you practice being peaceful. I believe I'm a very peaceful person, and I don't like harming the environment or harming animals, but also in order to eat and survive, like, some things have to be done and some things have to be done in order to maintain society. So I think it's a yes and a no. It's a controversial topic for sure.
I don't know. I don't know the answer to that. What I think of though is creation. And I think that in the creation story, like when sin entered the world, it affected all of God's creation. And so not only were humans affected by sin, but so was the earth, so were the animals. Death entered into God's like beautiful, good creation. There is something about caring for creation, I think, and being respectful of God's creation, nurturing God's creation, that I think we've maybe dismissed, or we don't care about it as much as we did. Sometimes I look at native peoples and they have this beautiful, it's almost a romantic way they engage with nature. And it's actually beautiful. If we could like praise God in that way, as the creator of like this beautiful nature, including animals, that would be really cool. We don't see that a lot, but I think it would be a cool thing to see more of. Yeah.
Yeah. Do you know what some other people had to say?
when we start talking about peace, we're not only talking about the rejection of warfare, the rejection of militarism, the rejection of treating those who oppose us with violence. We're talking about a variety of other things. Are we being violent with the environment? There's a good question. The 8th chapter of Romans says very carefully, all of creation is groaning as in its travail, suffering. And then it says, waiting. Waiting with earnest expectation for what? For the sons and the daughters of God to rescue it. To be committed to peace is to be committed to the ending of the violence of the environment. Strip mining violates the earth. This is a good thing that God created. The first chapter of Genesis, second chapter of Genesis tells us what God created, he created as good. When we pollute the atmosphere, are we doing violence to people? When we dump our garbage into the rivers, are we doing violence to the rivers? I'm not suggesting any New Age mindset that imparts some kind of personality to these things, but I am saying that these are sacred creations of God. We're coming more and more under the auspices of science to recognize that there is something very mystical about the physical universe. I used to think that when you got down to atomic structures, electrons, protons, neutrons, you were down to the basic elements of the universe and you could go no further. Over the last few years, string theory has come out. One of my colleagues in the field of academia, I'm an academician, I teach at a university, a Christian university, in just outside of Philadelphia called Eastern University. Close by is the University of Pennsylvania, where I was for 10 years on the faculty. And one of my colleagues at Penn, who's a physicist, said so well with string theory. Each electron, each neutron, each proton is vibrating sound. It's not solid, it's vibrating sound. I said, what are you saying? He's saying there's nothing, and he didn't even realize the religious implications of what he was saying. He's saying it's not what you think. It's not that material matter, that matter was just thrust into space. It's as though the whole universe, every atom, every electron, every proton, every neutron was spoken into existence. Whoa. I said, you know, that'll preach. That'll really preach. Is there something sacred about the universe? You say you're almost giving a kind of a mystical quality to the universe. Indeed, I am. I always say to my students, when Jesus was out in the middle of the Sea of Galilee and the storm came up, and he spoke to the winds and the waves and told them to be still, was that just theatrics? Was that just a thing that he was kind of playing with the disciples about? Or was there something about Jesus and his awesome power that he could speak to the winds and the waves and that they would obey him? In short, I'm back to the basic question. Are we going to take the Bible literally? Are we going to, in fact, say what happened there really happened? I think it did. The environment has to be treated with new respect. I head up a missionary work that developed in Haiti. It has two branches, one called Beyond Borders, the other called Haiti Partners. When you talk about Haiti and the suffering of that nation, the primary reason why that country is impoverished today is because of violence against nature. Almost all the trees in Haiti have been cut down and turned into charcoal to be used for cooking. The net result is that the island has been deforested. Whenever there's a hurricane that comes through Haiti, and that comes through at least once a year, The heavy rains wash all the topsoil into the sea. It's hard to grow anything in Haiti right now. Most of the food has to be imported. A nation which was once the most productive agricultural unit in the Caribbean has to import food because of the violence that has been done to nature. We are destroying the rainforest in Brazil. We destroy an area the size of a football field every minute. The rainforest, as any biologist will tell you, is the lungs of the planet. It's what turns carbon dioxide into oxygen once again. What are we doing as we destroy the rainforest? I mean, it's mind-boggling at the rate in which it is being destroyed. What's more is, and a lot of young people don't know this, in spite of their sophisticated education, almost every medicine that we employ for our health, penicillin being a case in point, is organic in origin. And I wonder, as all environmentalists wonder, how many cures to things like cancer or Parkinson's disease, you know, or Alzheimer's, diseases that are wrecking our people, our elderly people especially, are being destroyed as we destroy the rainforest. Who knows? But the organic elements that would give the medicines we need are being wiped out. We also have to talk about nonviolence in the family. We all know at this point from sociological studies, once again, I teach sociology at Eastern University, that when you hit a child, there is a strong probability that that child will become somebody who hits in adulthood. In short, the propensity to become a wife beater, to do violence against children, is almost an inevitability if, when that person was a child, he or she himself or herself was a victim of violence. There's another thing to be said. Being nonviolent is not only physical, it's also verbal. There's a lot of verbal violence that goes on in our world. Jesus talks about murder. He says, you know, you have been told you shouldn't kill. But any man or woman that calls his neighbor raca, what does that mean, raca? And I asked biblical scholars what that word means. Well, it's anybody who talks violently to another person is, in a sense, killing that person's soul. And Jesus said, more dangerous than those who would hurt your body are those who would hurt your soul. So think about that. In our talk, are we violent? Bullying, for instance, has become a major issue in today's society. I mean, do you have to hit a kid to bully him? How much bullying, driving people to suicide, as we're now having case after case brought to our attention, demonstrating that kids who are bullied get so depressed, so down on themselves that they kill themselves. How much of this is really physical violence, and how much of it is verbal? Mitt Romney, who is running for president, when he was about 15, 16 years old, was part of what he called a high school prank, in which they took a kid who, given the evidence, probably was gay, had his hair bleached blonde, pinned him to the ground, and while he cried and begged, cut the hair off of his head. And of course, I would say that we cannot judge a person today by what he was at 15. And so when Mitt Romney says, I've outgrown that kind of behavior, I see how wrong it was. I accept that. But that very event, and I hear people say on television interviews, hey, boys will be boys. That's exactly the point. What did you do to that kid? He's dead now. He died in his 20s, and I wonder what the circumstances surrounding that death were. Was he suicidal? I think that the way in which the Christian community, especially the evangelical community, talks about gays and lesbians and has generated a homophobia within the church is violence. And I think has to be challenged. It's verbal violence. But there was an old saying when I was a kid, sticks and stones will hurt your bones, but names will never harm you. Wrong. If there's anything that's wrong, it's that saying. Sticks and stones may hurt your bones, but I want to tell you, verbal attacks are even more severe. I had a good time in high school. I went to a tough inner city school in West Philadelphia. Early on, they tested me. A group of guys challenged me and told me that they wanted my lunch money, and if I didn't give it to them, they would beat me up. And they beat me up. But it didn't affect me. As a matter of fact, I almost became respected because I was willing to endure that punishment. I ended up being president of the student body. But what if the attack had not been physical? Suppose I had been labeled, quote unquote, a chicken, a sissy, a baby, somebody who couldn't stand up for his rights. What would my life have been like in West Philadelphia High? In short, the beating that I took the second day of school would have been nothing to the destruction of my soul and heart and mind of a verbal beating that I would take for the next 3.5 years. We have to be careful when we talk about violence, that we include violence against the environment, violence against each other in a verbal manner, violence in the home. Here's one that I know will upset every Mennonite and Brethren in Christ person, because they all talk about being nonviolent, nonviolent. We're a peace church. I find that making a sport out of hunting is something that the church needs to challenge. I am not suggesting that we all become vegetarians, although we'd be a lot healthier if we were. But I am saying this, if you're killing for food, that's one thing. But when you do it for the fun of it, I have to raise some very serious questions. My Bible says not a sparrow falls to the ground that the Heavenly Father does not empathize with, does not care about. Does God care about a deer? And when these members of peace churches say, yeah, I'm gonna go out and show my masculinity. I'm gonna shoot a deer. Why? Do you need the food? Just for the fun of it. It's a real he-man. When you've got to prove your masculinity by shooting a deer, you ought to take a good look at yourself and ask yourself whether or not you are like Jesus. I'm not suggesting that animals be out of the food chain. I am saying when you have made an enjoyable thing out of killing, when this becomes a sport, I think you're being violent. So at this point, maybe all the Brethren in Christ and Mennonite Christians are saying, I was with them up to that point. Violence is violence. And before we point to Presbyterians and Baptists and Methodists and say, you're violent, I think that those in the peace churches have to say, let's examine ourselves. Let's look at the beam in our own eye before we look for the splinter in the brother's eye. So these are some of the things that come to mind when I think about violence. I talk about the language, the words that we use, the way we talk to our children, the way we talk to our wives, the way we talk to our husbands. I've studied as a sociologist the conversations that go on between husbands and wives. And they often talk to each other in ways that they would never talk to anybody else. Violent language, violence against the environment, violence against animals. Violence is all around us. When Jesus said peace, he used the word shalom. And that word means not just that there's an absence of war, but everything in the world becomes like Jesus wants it to be. There's no question that in the peaceable kingdom described in passages like the 65th chapter of Isaiah, when the lion and the lamb lie down together, even the violence of nature comes to an end. Even the violence in nature ceases. We really have to ask ourselves some very serious questions. How violent are we?
More.